I see you have now walked out of the room where I led you to talk about real chemistry, and you are now back in your mechanical world. I'm sorry we've ended up like this. For a moment, I thought we were making progress. Ooh, that is some serious shade. That's not the kind of letter you want from a Nobel Prize winner. It's like a beloved grandfather saying, "I think you've made some really bad life choices." I'm Peter. I'm going to go through the 2003 Drexler-Smalley debate for your amusement. My PhD is in chemistry, and I have experience using photolithography for microfabrication as well as building some simple bio-inspired nanomachines, so I have some of the relevant background and context to explain this. That short passage was from one of Richard Smalley's later letters in the back and forth debate in Chemical and Engineering News. Smalley won the Nobel Prize for discovering fullerenes, weird ball-shaped carbon molecules. He was kind of a big deal. On the other side of the debate was K.R.X. Drexler, who published The Engines of Creation, this book right here. And it was a popular book on nanotechnology. He also co-founded the Foresight Institute as a place to think carefully about nanotech and nanotech policy. So Drexler's book is all about the promise and the dangers of what he called molecular nanotechnology. He imagined what we might do with control over matter at the molecular level, and then he went on to imagine methods for how we might get to devices at this nanoscale. He imagined we might build atomic scale assemblers that can place molecules into specific positions where they can form bonds. The assembler will then build up molecules into materials and build materials into human scale objects. It'd be like a 3D printer that can build things with atomic precision. Anything from a bowl of rice to a smartphone. Now that sounds great, but it comes with some scary possibilities, like what if we built self-replicating nanomachines and they escaped? Now, when all of this was going down in the late 90s and early aughts, and people were thinking about this possibility of this kind of technological development, pop culture conceptions of nanotechnology were terrifying. Like, Drexler's ideas definitely fed into worries. Just for context, here are some examples. In my last video, I talked about Neal Stephenson's 1995 novel, The Diamond Age. Now, that story is about people living in a nanotech-enabled future where anything material can be created from these sophisticated 3D printers that Neal Stephenson called matter compilers and Drexler calls assemblers. Now, this creates a dystopian future where a few people have control over the feed that supplies all the energy and matter to the assemblers. The Victorians control that feed and everyone else can come serve them or go starve somewhere. Another example in the pop culture is Sun Microsystems co-founder and chief scientist Bill Joy. He published an essay in Wired in 2000 called "Why the Future Doesn't Need Us." That essay explicitly describes the dangers of runaway self-replicating nanotechnology. He wonders, could nanomachines replicate endlessly and convert the whole biosphere into copies of themselves, a sort of gray goo scenario? So this is a reasonably big deal in pop culture. Some of this can be traced right back to Drexler's popularizing these ideas in The Engines of Creation. But 20 to 30 years later, there's no assembler, there's no matter compiler. It doesn't look like that's going to happen anytime soon. Certainly nothing's even close to approaching a gray goo scenario. So why not? So Smalley wrote a piece in Scientific American called "Of Chemistry, Love, and Nanobots," and he explained in the late 90s, early 2000s, why he thought there would be no assemblers. He acknowledged that you could maybe take a molecule and a finely controlled nanoprobe and stick that molecule to another molecule and make a product. You need the appropriate equipment, like the scanning probe microscope, but making one product molecule at a time is crazy slow. It would take millennia to print a grain of rice. The only way such a strategy could be useful is if you could make those molecules into a self-replicator. Here's a quote. "Imagine if this one nanobot were so versatile that it could build anything, as long as it had a supply of the right kinds of atoms, a source of energy, and a set of instructions for exactly what to build. We could work out those detailed instructions with a computer and then radio them to the nanobot. The nanobot could build anything and it could build a copy of itself. Self-replicating nanobots are really interesting. If they're feasible, then the notion of a machine that can build anything from a CD player to a skyscraper in a remarkably short time doesn't seem so far-fetched." So we can imagine this like the print head of a 3D printer. A single print head maybe might be an interesting scientific tool if it could print single molecules, but a practical matter assembler could only really be made out of these print heads if they could self-replicate, if you could print another print head. But could we build an assembler good enough to build another assembler? Could we build print heads sufficiently precise to print an additional print head? Smalley says no, he thinks that's impossible. Now I'll get to the technical reasons why Smalley thinks it can't be done later. He calls the main problems the fat fingers problem and the sticky fingers problem. But for now, I want to stay focused on why he thought it was important to communicate this opinion. See, kids were starting to get scared of this idea. It was in the sci-fi movies at the time. It seemed remarkably scary. And Smalley says, students were asked to write an essay on why I'm a nano-geek. Of the essays I read, nearly half assumed that self-replicating nanobots were possible, and most were deeply worried about what would happen in their future as these nanobots spread around the world. While our future in the real world will be challenging, and there are real risks, there will be no such monster as the self-replicating mechanical nanobot of your dreams. So he's trying to reassure people. He's trying to step into the public and say, this particular thing is not a threat. If Smalley's correct, we have kind of good news, bad news scenario. The good news, safety. No gray goo scenario. Nothing's going to absorb the planet in nanobots. The bad news is that, well, we're not going to get to have post-scarcity matter assemblers anytime soon. Drexler's on the other side of the debate. He's in the we should be careful of the nanotechnology revolution camp. He would say that he's pro-technology development, but wants us not to move fast and break things because, you know, gray goo. And he's not just making stuff up. Drexler did experimental work. He made a good case that we can build something using the pick-and-place molecular 3D printer idea. And he believes that would lead to assemblers and their related dangers if allowed to develop long enough. Quote Drexler, I have a 20-year history of technical publications in this area and consistently describe systems quite unlike the straw man Smalley has attacked. My proposal is, and always has been, to guide the chemical synthesis of complex structures by mechanically positioning reactive molecules, not by manipulating atoms. The proposal has been defended successfully again and again in journal articles, in my MIT doctoral thesis, the basis of nanosystems, molecular machinery, manufacturing, nanocomputation, and before scientific audiences around the world. It rests on well-established physical principles. So if Smalley brought his Nobel Prize to the debate, Drexler brought his receipts. He has a PhD from MIT. He has peer-reviewed papers on building molecules by mechanical assembly, that is to say, mechanosynthesis. And he suggests maybe Smalley's also making some false arguments, even a fallacy. Your reliance on a straw man attack might lead a thoughtful observer to suspect that no one has identified a valid criticism of my work. For this, I should perhaps thank you. Ooh, that's a real clap back. And then he concludes with some motivation questioning of his own. You apparently fear that my warnings of long-term dangers will hinder further funding of your current research. Stating, we should not let this fuzzy-minded nightmare dream scare us away from nanotechnology. The nanotech initiative should go forward. However, I have from the beginning argued that the potential for abuse of advanced nanotechnologies makes vigorous research by the US and its allies imperative. Many have found these arguments persuasive. In an open discussion, I believe they will prevail. In contrast, your attempt to calm the public through false claims of impossibility will inevitably fail, placing your colleagues at risk of a destructive backlash. Drexlerian mechanosynthesis nanotechnology is not impossible, he says. My warnings about dangers are completely valid. You'll see. You'll all see. Quick aside, these are two very different approaches to scientific communication. Smalley uses poetic analogy and speaks of to a general audience, while Drexler is using citations and a more technical language. I think Smalley was more effective at communicating in this context, but others, like Ray Kurzweil, rather infamous or famous technological prognosticator, think that Drexler actually made the better technical points, and maybe he did. Editor Peter here. I had originally intended to go through the sort of back and forth in chemical and engineering news that was known as the Smalley-Drexler debate, but in retrospect, it turns into a bit of a technical pissing match and is probably not worth going through in that much detail. We have 25 years of hindsight, and it's reasonably clear that Smalley was right. at least insofar as saying that it was much more difficult than Drexler thought it was going to be to do this mechanosynthetic approach to building nanotechnology. Certainly there has been a lot of advances in nanotechnology since then, but not so much in the way that Drexler predicted. Now, the reason Smalley thought it was going to be so difficult, and I think it's been validated, is what he called the fat fingers problem and the sticky fingers problem. So let's go through those in a little more detail. Fat fingers problem. That nanobot printhead can only have manipulators made of molecules. It can't be using magic fingers smaller than atoms to pick and place other atoms. That puts a limit on how precisely you can hold the thing you're trying to make react. To use a 3D printer analogy, it's a printhead trying to print a duplicate of itself, but the duplicate must be as precise as the original piece. Any error is going to make any subsequent generation worse until they fail entirely. When biology makes stuff like proteins, it solves that problem by containing the whole reaction of the next amino acid attachment to the protein in the heart of the ribosome, another big protein. It controls that environment so precisely that it makes the chemical reaction precise. A printhead can't wrap all the way around its reaction. It has to hover above it. If you make the printhead more like a ribosome, it can't be a printhead anymore. Then there's the sticky fingers problem. This robotic printhead needs to manipulate molecules using strong chemical bonds in order to be precise. Weak bonds are floppy, but it needs to make stronger chemical bonds in the printed product, right? The pieces have to obey the same rules while being picked up as when being placed down, because they're molecules, they just obey chemical rules. In this 3D printer analogy, the printhead is made of the same material it's trying to spit out. Why would that material stick to the print job instead of the printhead? They're made of the same stuff. That's the sticky fingers problem. Now, Drexler says these are not real problems, these are just the details. If you can't make such a printhead, then we'll make something more like a ribosome. If you can't print on a surface, we'll spit out the products in solution. They can self-assemble. And okay, yeah, that might work, but it won't be an assembler anymore. It'll be a fermentation vat. And making the precise nanotechnological product you want from a more lifelike system is different from the conceptions in the engines of creation. So I side with Smalley. I think both Drexler and Smalley agree that biology is already a prototype nanotechnology, and I think that both agree that a tiny robotic arm can be used to make like a single molecule react with another molecule, and where they disagree is how powerful and versatile that type of nanotechnology could be. 25 years of progress suggest that Smalley was right. Mechanosynthesis, pick and place, 3D printing at the molecular level has not come close to making an assembler. So let's talk about what worked and what didn't. Self-replicating nanobots? No, we're not even close. Biology is way ahead of us. We're just barely able to make 3D protein structures most of the time. Making them work together to do all the sophisticated reactions of self-replication is still very much Mother Nature's kitchen. Self-assembling smiley faces? Yeah, we can do that. We can make little smiley faces out of DNA. It doesn't look anything like Drexler's pick-and-place nanotechnology of the 3D printing variety, but DNA origami can make nano objects from a molecular size substrate and is really cool. Nanolithography, that's another one that really exists, comes close to the molecular level. Silicon traces in modern chips are 150 atoms wide or thereabouts. There's no assembler technology going on, that's just sophisticated photolithography. There are also some amazing micromechanical systems out there, but they're nowhere near an assembler in size or sophistication. And I admit, I, like Smalley, am skeptical that that's ever going to be the approach we take. Whew. Anyhow, yeah, what a debate. It is really worth reading. Of course, I'll put links to all of my sources in the description, and I hope you'll check them out. If you like this kind of thing, tune back in next time. We will see you then.